Microsoft MS-DOS Operating System Version 5.0 User's Guide and Reference to help you relax, sleep, or become more familiar and acclimated to this exceptional new operating system if you happen to be a new user of it. Please make yourself comfortable as we are about to begin. Contents. Welcome. New features of MS-DOS version 5.0. Conventions. Part 1. MS-DOS Fundamentals. Chapter 1. Learning about your computer. Chapter 2. Command line basics. Chapter 3. MS-DOS Shell basics. MS-DOS. Chapter 4, Working with Files. Chapter 5, Working with Directories. Chapter 6, Managing Disks. Chapter 7, Advanced Command Techniques. Chapter 8, Customizing MS-DOS Shell. Chapter 9, Working with MS-DOS Editor. Part 3. Customizing MS-DOS. Chapter 10. Working with Batch Programs. Chapter 11. Customizing Your System. Chapter 12. Optimizing Your System. Chapter 13. Customizing for International Use. Part 4. MS-DOS Reference. Chapter 14, Commands. Chapter 15, Device Drivers. The Appendix. Keyboard Layouts and Code Pages. And lastly, the Index. Welcome. Welcome to Microsoft MS-DOS. The most widely used operating system for personal computers. MS-DOS version 5.0 includes many new features that turn your computer into a powerful tool for your business or personal use. These features are described in detail later in this introduction. Features of MS-DOS version 5.0. The ability to run MS-DOS in the high memory area, HMA. The ability to run certain device drivers and programs in the upper memory area if you have an 8386 or higher system. MS-DOS Shell. An improved graphical interface that you can use to manage programs and switch between them. Added data security. MS-DOS version 5.0 includes two new commands, unformat and undelete. These commands allow you to undo a format or delete operation, restoring your disk or file to its original state. Online help for all MS-DOS commands and MS-DOS Shell. MS-DOS Editor, a new full-screen text editor that you can use to easily create and modify text files. The ability to create large disk partitions. apps easily. With MS-DOS version 5.0, you can create disk partitions of up to 2 gigabytes. The ability to search for files through multiple levels of directories. Added functionality to the directory command that enables you to sort directory listings by file name, type of file, the date and time that files were created, and file size. DOS key, a program you can use to recall, edit, and carry out commands that you have already used. MS-DOS QBasic, an improved basic programming environment that includes extensive online help. The ability to access more than 2 hard disk drives. Support for 2.88 megabyte floppy disks. A new setup program with online help, which guides you through each step of the setup process and provides help whenever you need it. Part 1, MS-DOS Fundamentals. Processor and memory. The central processing unit, or CPU, and memory are located on chips inside the system unit. The CPU is the brain of your computer. This is the place where your computer interprets and processes information. You may have heard computer memory referred to as RAM. The term RAM stands for random access memory. The instructions that your computer gets and the information your computer processes are kept in RAM during your work session. Your computer's RAM is not a permanent storage place for information. It is active only when your computer is on. When you turn off your computer, information is deleted from memory. Monitor. The monitor has a screen that displays information, such as the instructions you send to your computer and the information and results your computer sends back after interpreting your instructions. The screen may display information in one color or in several colors. A color monitor won't display color unless you have the appropriate video card. A video card fits inside your computer and determines the screen resolution and number of colors your monitor can display. Keyboard. You use use the keyboard to type instructions for your computer and to type information you want your computer to process. All keyboards have letter keys, punctuation keys, and a space bar, which resemble the keys on a typewriter. Most keyboards also have function, numeric, and arrow keys, in addition to Alt, Control, Delete, and Enter or Return keys. Pictured here, you can see the difference between a standard keyboard and an extended keyboard. The set of programs, procedures, and related documentation associated with a computer system. A program is a coded set of instructions that interprets the information you give to the computer with the keyboard or mouse, and then directs your computer to carry out a task. Different kinds of software perform different kinds of tasks. Examples of two kinds of software are operating systems, such as the Apple operating system, and programs, such as Microsoft Excel and Lotus 1-2-3. There is a wide variety of software programs, including word processors, accounting packages, computer-aided design systems, and games. Looking at MS-DOS. MS-DOS, like other operating systems, manages the flow of information to and from the various parts of your computer system. MS-DOS includes commands that you can use to perform these tasks, such as manage files and directories, maintain disks, configure hardware, and more. MS-DOS command line. The MS-DOS command line is where you type commands. The command prompt indicates that you are at the command line. The prompt may be a drive letter followed by a backslash. For example, C:\, or a backslash and the name of a directory. For example, C:\ pictures of my cats. MS-DOS shell. In addition to the command line, you can use MS-DOS shell to work with many of the MS-DOS commands. MS-DOS shell offers a visual way of working with MS-DOS. It displays drives, directories, files, and programs available for your use. Using files and directories. The information your computer uses is stored in files. The instructions used to run a program are stored in program files. And the information you create by using a program is stored in data files. As you work with a program, MS-DOS processes the information stored in program files and passes it along to your system when it is needed. When you are finished using the program, your data files are stored on a disk. Organizing files into directories. A disk can hold several hundred or even thousands of files, depending on its size. The more files you have, the more difficult it is to keep track of them. To help you keep track of your files, you can use MS-DOS commands to group your files into directories. Chapter 2. Command Line Basics. MS-DOS indicates the command line by displaying the command prompt. For example, C:\ ; (#). You type commands at the prompt to specify tasks you want MS-DOS to perform. For example, if you want the MS-DOS version number displayed, do the following. 1. Type VER. 2. Press Enter. The software version number appears. Parts of a command. An MS-DOS command has up to 3 parts. Every command has a command name. Some commands require one or more parameters that identify the object you want MS-DOS to act on. The command name. The command name, which you type first, states the action you want MS-DOS to carry out. Some commands consist only of a command name. Most MS-DOS commands, however, require more than a name. Typing a command. The flashing underscore on the command line is the cursor. The cursor shows you where to type the command. When you type a character, the cursor moves one space to the right. If you make a mistake, press backspace to delete the character to the left of the cursor. Shortcuts to typing a command. MS-DOS has editing keys that change or repeat the command you've typed. Two of the most commonly used keys are F1 and F3. F1 F1 displays the previous command one character at a time. F3 displays all of the previous commands. Chapter 3, MS-DOS Shell Basics. Through the use of color and graphics, MS-DOS Shell offers a visual way of working with MS-DOS. Information is set up in different areas on your screen, making it easy to find. For example, when you first run MS-DOS Shell, the following information is displayed on your screen: the disk drives available on your system, the directory structure or tree for the current disk drive, a list of files in the current directory, a list of programs that you can run. Starting MS-DOS Shell. If MS-DOS Shell was set up to run whenever you start your system, MS-DOS Shell appears on your screen when you start MS-DOS version 5.0. If the command prompt appears instead, you can start MS-DOS Shell from there. The MS-DOS Shell window. When you first start MS-DOS Shell, your screen is divided into different areas as follows: area title, drive icons, menu bar, scroll bar, selection cursor, title bar, program list area, directory tree area, status bar, file list area, mouse pointer. Areas in the MS-DOS Shell window: drive icons, the directory tree, the file list, the program list, the active task list. Working with menus. Menus are lists of commands. Menu names appear in the menu bar along the top of the MS-DOS Shell window. Selecting and canceling a menu. Choosing commands. You use the commands on menus to specify various tasks you want MS-DOS to carry out. For example, you use some commands to assign characteristics to programs. Working with dialog boxes. Typing text in a text box. Sometimes you are required to type text in a box within a dialog box, as in the following copy file dialog box. Using scroll bars, some areas of the MS-DOS Shell window and some dialog boxes contain scroll bars. If there is more information than can fit in an area or list, a scroll box appears within the scroll bar. The size of the scroll box tells you how much of the available information you can currently see. Changing views. When you first run MS-DOS Shell, directories, file names, and program groups are displayed. A program group is a collection of programs that can have information associated with them, such as startup commands or passwords. You can view your directories, files, and programs in several ways. can configure MS-DOS shell to show directories and files on a disk, directories and files on two disks, files in a selected directory, and information about the files, and so on. Working with files and directories, MS-DOS shell is an efficient tool for organizing and working with files and directories. It displays a list of your directories, subdirectories, and files. Associating files with a program. Suppressing confirmation messages. Repainting and updating the screen. If you run a terminate and stay resident TSR program from MS-DOS shell, that program might still be displayed after you quit the program. Make the MS-DOS shell window visible again, you need to repaint the screen. Getting help. Online help provides a quick way to get information about MS-DOS shell basics and using menus, commands, dialog boxes, dialog box options, and procedures. You can get help in three ways: by pressing F1, by selecting the help button that appears in most dialog boxes, or by using the help menu. You can get help on a related procedure. Leaving MS-DOS shell. You can leave MS-DOS shell, although personally, I don't see why you would ever want to, and move to the command prompt in two ways. You can quit MS-DOS shell temporarily, or you can quit MS-DOS shell and remove it from your system's memory before you switch to the command prompt. And now, it is time for part two, working with MS-DOS. I hope you have been enjoying yourself so far and are in a nice, calm, and relaxed state. Perhaps very tired, maybe even falling asleep. Chapter 4. Working with files. Files organize information that your computer uses. MS-DOS itself is stored in files that are read into memory when you start your system. There are a number of types of files. Each file has a unique name and location, in addition to a group of attributes that describes it. File names. Every file has a name. Most files also have an extension. The name always appears first, and the extension is always separated from the name by a period. Example, myfile.ext. Types of files. Program files. Program files contain the programs that your computer runs. Specialized data files. It is common for a program to produce files that contain codes which can be used only by that program. Unformatted text files. Unformatted text files contain only text. Almost all computer programs, including MS-DOS, use a system called the American Standard Code for Information Interchange, or ASCII, to represent text. System files. System files contain information about your hardware and are sometimes called device drivers. Batch programs. Batch programs are unformatted text files that contain MS-DOS commands. File size, date and time. Using wildcards. If you want to perform the same task for a group of files, you don't have to use the same command repeatedly for each file name in the group. You can use wildcards to specify groups of files. You can use wildcards to match files. Viewing text files. To view the contents of a text file, use the type command. For example, to view the contents of the mymanifesto.txt file on a disk in drive B, you would use the following command, type b colon mymanifesto.txt. Copying files. The copy command is your primary tool for organizing and making copies of files. With the copy command, you can do the following. Copy a file from one directory to another. Copy a group of files by using wildcards. Rename a file as you copy it. And more. This is just more information on copying files. You can copy a file to a printer. To print an unformatted text file, copy it to the port to which your printer is attached, as in the following command, copy mymanifesto.txt lpt1. Copying files by using MS-DOS shell. Renaming a file. To change the name of a file without changing its location, use the rename command. This command is especially helpful for organizing files. Printing text files. Printing files. Using the print queue. Deleting files. As you work with MS-DOS, you may want to remove files that are no longer useful, or that you may not want certain authority figures to find on your computer, such as your parents, the FBI, or the KGB. You can delete a single file, selected groups of files, or all files in a directory or on a disk. Once you delete files, you might not be able to recover them. Information on deleting a single file, deleting a group of files, deleting all files in a directory, deleting files by using MS-DOS shell, recovering deleted files. When you delete a file, MS-DOS does not delete the data in the file. Instead, it marks the file as deleted, so MS-DOS can reuse the area of the disk that was occupied by the deleted file. The data remains on the disk until MS-DOS records the data of another file in the same region of the disk. Moving files. Comparing files. Viewing and changing file attributes. Finding text within a file. Searching for files by using MS-DOS shell. Getting information by using MS-DOS shell. That takes us to our next chapter. Working with directories. A disk is like a file cabinet. It has folders that contain groups of files. These folders, called directories, help you organize your files. When a folder in a file cabinet contains so much information that you can no longer easily find what you want, you subdivide it, or you might throw it out, or burn it. In the same way, when a directory on your disk becomes too large, you can divide it into subdirectories. Understanding directories. Directories are most important when you use a hard disk. If you use only floppy disks, you can probably keep files organized by putting them on different disks. With a hard disk, which usually can store more information than a floppy disk, it becomes necessary to organize files into categories so you can find them more easily. Directory tree. Directory names. Paths. The current drive. The current directory. Let us move on to the next chapter, since we are getting close to running out of time. Chapter 6, Managing Disks. Disks provide long-term information storage. The information you save on disks remains intact until you delete it. In contrast, random access memory, remember that from the very beginning, RAM, as it's also known, provides short-term information storage. Information stored in RAM is lost each time you turn off your computer. Types of disks. Disks store information on magnetic surfaces. In a floppy disk, the magnetic surface is a thin, flexible disk inside a protective plastic cover. A hard disk has two or more rigid disks stacked on top of each other in a sealed case. A hard disk is also called a fixed disk because it remains in your system. Once your hard disk is installed, it should not be removed unless it is damaged or you upgrade to a larger disk or you have concerns about certain authoritarian figures wanting to gain access to your hard drives. Bytes, kilobytes, and megabytes. Files are measured in bytes. 1 byte is the amount of space it takes to store a character. A kilobyte is 1,024 bytes. A megabyte is 1,024 K, about 1,000,000 bytes. Types of disk drives. Formatting disks. Before you can use a disk, you must prepare it by using the format command. The disk may or may not have been previously formatted. Safeguarding information on a disk. The mirror program saves information about a disk. This information provides a safeguard in case you mistakenly formatted a disk by using the /u switch with the format command. The mirror program is also useful for recovering data from a corrupted disk. Formatting a disk. More information on that. Specifying disk capacity. Formatting a floppy disk by using ms.shell. Unformatting a disk. To recover as much information as possible from a hard or floppy disk that has been reformatted, use the unformat command, as in the following example. Unformat c colon. Creating a system disk. System disks contain 3 MS-DOS system files, io.sys, msdos.sys, and command.com. When you start your system, these 3 files are copied from the system disk to your system's random access memory. Labeling a disk. Each disk can have a name called the volume label and a number called the volume serial number. MS-DOS uses the volume serial number to keep track of which disk is in a drive. MS-DOS assigns a serial number to a disk when you format it. Assigning and deleting labels. To assign a volume label to a disk, use the label command. For example, the following command gives the disk in drive A the label disk 1. Label A disk 1. A label can contain no more than 11 characters, including spaces. So you could, for example, also call your disk where's disk 1. Viewing labels. Making a backup disk. Backing up a directory. Backing up a directory and its subdirectories. Backing up selected files. Adding files to a backup disk. Making backup disks by using MS-DOS shell, restoring directories and files, okay, and much more. Let us move on to the next chapter. Just to save some time. Very 7. Advanced command techniques, redirection characters, editing keys, and the DOS key program enable you to perform many useful tasks. A redirection character changes the place that a command gets information from or sends information to. By using editing keys, you can quickly view and edit your last command rather than retype it. The DOS key program stores the commands you type, so you don't have to retype them to use them. Redirecting command input and output. Redirecting the output of a command. Redirecting the input to a command. Passing information through filter commands. Controlling the screen display by using the more command. Searching for text by using the find command. Sorting text files. Combining commands with redirection characters. Using editing keys. Copying a command without retyping it. Editing a command. Fixing a mistyped command. Using the F1 and insert keys to edit. Using the F2 key to edit. Using DOS key to work with commands. Installing DOS key. Typing more than one command on a line. Viewing previous commands. Using DOS key to work with macros. A macro is a set of commands that you can carry out by typing the name of the macro. A macro is very much like a batch program. Both contain sets of commands that you can carry out by typing a name. Creating a macro. Running a macro. Editing a macro. Saving a macro. Deleting a macro. Using replaceable parameters. Redirecting input and output. That takes us to our next chapter. Customizing MS-DOS shell. But because we are running out of time, let us just go through towards the end and see what the next sections are. There is part 3, customizing MS-DOS. As you work with MS-DOS, you'll find yourself repeatedly typing identical sequences of commands. For example, you might often type the same 3 commands to change the current drive, change the current directory, and then start a program. By using MS-DOS, you can store commands in a batch program or batch file. So instead of typing commands individually, you need only type the name of the batch program. MS-DOS carries out this batch of commands as if you had typed the commands individually from the keyboard. So this section is dedicated to working with batch programs. Chapter 11, customizing your system. You can customize the way MS-DOS uses hardware, memory, and files. For example, you can customize the way MS-DOS interacts with your keyboard and monitor. You can also change the amount of memory that MS-DOS reserves for itself and for storing files. There's a whole chapter optimizing your system. To optimize your system is to customize it so that it uses its resources most efficiently for the tasks you usually perform, such as to make more memory available for programs and to improve your system's speed as much as possible while retaining enough memory to run your programs. Freeing conventional memory. Running MS-DOS in extended memory. Much more. Okay. We'll take a look. Running programs in the upper memory area. Okay. Then we have part 4, MS-DOS reference. Chapter is complete reference for the commands supplied with MS-DOS version 5.0. Take a look at some of these. Here's all the different commands: append, assign, attrib, backup, break, chcp, chdir with cd in parentheses, check disk, cls, command, comp, copy, CTTY, date, debug, delete, erase, DIR for directory, disk comp, disk copy, edit, exit, fast open F disk, join, print, sort, volume, X copy, etc. Patch commands. So, these are all the different commands, the parameters, switches. Buffers, a call, chcp, chdir, check disk, which creates and displays a status report for a disk, a copy, copies one or more files to another location. Etc., etc. Czechoslovakia, Denmark,